Another institution downgrades its economic growth forecast for the Philippines as it sees inflation staying elevated. Andrea Taguinas joins us on the line for more on this. Andy, go ahead.
Good afternoon, Stanley. The Banco Central ng Pilipinas may need to keep the key policy rate at its current level for longer than most Southeast Asian economies as inflation in the Philippines remains elevated. That's according to the ASEAN Plus 3 Macroeconomic Research Office. In a press briefing on Wednesday, AMRO chief economist Ho E. Kor said this will depend on factors such as food prices, which he noted were uncertainty at the moment. Inflation rose to 5.3% in August, while the September Consumer Price Index is expected to be released tomorrow, Thursday, October 5th. Kor pointed out that the BSP has also acknowledged the need to maintain the status quo until inflation falls within the government's 2-4% target range. Despite the recent uptick in food prices, Kor said the full-year inflation should still settle at 5.5% this 2023 before easing further to 3.8% or within targets by 2024. Still, Kor said the threat of El Nino and its impact on food prices remains.
It's already moderating. It's just sort of tick around because of the high inflation. The food prices have picked up. But we think that's sort of a supply shock, transitory. We need to see going forward, you know, how bad this El Nino is. If it gets worse, then I think the food prices will go up everywhere, not just in the Philippines, but you know, the rest of the region.
And Stanley, as you mentioned, AMRO was one of the institutions that downgraded its growth forecast for the Philippines. It expects the Philippine economy to expand by 5.9% this year, below the lower band of the government's 6 to 7% growth target. Stanley.
All right, thank you so much for that story, Andy. The Philippine president lifts the price cap on rice, which he imposed last month to rein in on surging prices of the staple grain. Ferdinand Marcos Jr. spoke Wednesday at a rice distribution event in Taguig. The concurrent agriculture chief says the Philippines can further stretch its buffer stock to more than 2 months, with the harvest season set this month.
Tinatanggal na natin yung mga control. Pero hindi ibig sabihin basta ganun na lang. Dahil kailangan pa rin natin ayusin ang agricultural sector. We will continue the assistance that we have been giving to farmers, number one. Also, the assistance that we have been given to those most underprivileged families.
Marcos also acknowledged that the higher rice prices may have affected his approval ratings, which saw a double-digit drop in September.
I completely understand it, and that's why we're working very, very hard to make sure that this comes up again. Not because of the survey, that's not important to me. What's important to me is that we make sure that people have enough to eat and that it is affordable to them.
Moving on, more loans from the World Bank pushes the Philippines to its top 5 borrowers this year. Let's now bring in Denise inside for details on that and more. Denise.
Thank you, Stanley. Now, the lender's annual report showed the Philippines at number 5 with commitments worth $2.3 billion. Manila joins other nations such as India, Turkey, Indonesia, and Ukraine in the list. The World Bank says these commitments are meant to support programs to strengthen the Philippines' financial sector stability, expand financial inclusion, and bolster sustainable financing for mitigating climate risks. Manila was 2 notches higher in the World Bank's top borrowers list from its 7th spot in 2022. The Philippines and Lithuania agree on Tuesday to collaborate on areas of technology, cybersecurity, education, and people-to-people exchanges. During his presentation of credentials to President Marcos in Malacañang, Lithuanian Ambassador Ricardas Lepavičius said, the two countries can share experiences in addressing mutual concerns despite their distance. He adds the two nations can work together on laser technology since Lithuania is a pioneer in laser development and production. President Marcos, for his part, said technology brings the solution to many problems. Time for some local corporate stories, starting with SM Investment Corporation, which is optimistic its portfolio investments will contribute more than 10% to its overall earnings in the medium term. This, as the firm says, its portfolio business is now delivering double-digit contribution collectively. The company has invested in Philippine geothermal production company and in logistics companies like Airspeed and To-Go, which reported a turnaround profit last year. Meanwhile, PH One World Developers, the real estate arm of the Megawide Group, eyes earnings of 11 billion pesos from two projects. The said projects are the 337-unit Northscapes San Jose del Monte in Bulacan and its 986-unit Modern Lofts Ortigas Hills in Rizal. And finally, financial services company Sun Life Financial completes its acquisition of Dialogue Health Technologies. Headquartered in Montreal, Canada, Dialogue is the country's premier health and wellness virtual care platform. Dialogue will operate as a standalone entity of Sun Life Canada and will continue to provide services to all their customers and distribution partners. For our numbers that matter this Wednesday, 7.2%. That's the bank lending growth in the Philippines amid the high interest rate environment. The central bank says the growth in August is lower than July's 7.7%. Data from the BSP also showed domestic liquidity in the country grew by 6.8% to 16.5 trillion in the same month, up from July's 5.7%.